You're coming to the end of the forbearance period and you're not sure if you're going to be able to keep making that mortgage payment. The best thing you can do is apply for a loan modification while you're in forbearance. I'm going to go through an actual loan modification application and I'm going to show you exactly how to fill it out and the best way for you to get a loan modification, lower your payment, and save your home. Did you know that you do not qualify for a loan modification if you're current with your mortgage? What that means is that if you apply for a loan modification and you're not late, a bank will deny you for not being late. However, did you also know that because you're in a forbearance, you actually qualify as someone who can apply for a loan modification and maybe get a lower payment? The best time to apply for a loan modification is while you're in forbearance. You do not need to be late, you don't get the credit hit, and you might actually get a lower payment and you might be able to afford your home when you come out of forbearance. I'm an attorney here in Miami and I was around in 2008 during the last crash and helped thousands of people with their loan modification applications. I've been representing people since then, filling out their loan modification applications and helping them save their homes by lowering their payments. I'm going to go through an actual loan modification application from Wells Fargo Bank, which is similar to every other bank, which will help you fill out your loan modification application and hopefully get you a lower payment so you can save your home and get on with your life after the coronavirus is over. Couple things to remember before we start. The best time to apply for loan modification, as I mentioned before, is during forbearance. Don't wait till after forbearance. If you wait till after the forbearance, the bank is going to deny you because you're current. You cannot apply for loan modification being current. Being current means that the bank does not believe you have hardship. So if you apply while you're in forbearance, the bank has already accepted you have a hardship. Therefore, they will accept a loan modification application from you and maybe you get a lower payment. Okay, let's start the unboxing of the loan modification from Wells Fargo. So I believe this is the very first attempt to do a loan modification application unboxing on YouTube. And what that means is we're going to open up an actual loan modification application and I'm going to go through each one of the forms and give you tips on how to fill out the forms so that you can get a loan modification from your bank. So this is from Wells Fargo. Wells Fargo is actually the best one in terms of their presentation. They send you a very beautiful package. Don't worry if you have a different bank other than Wells Fargo, because the forms that we're going to go through are the same for every single bank. Some banks require actually more things, but these are basically the same forms that every bank will require when you apply for loan modification. When we open up the forms here, they have a beautiful setup here, setup guide, step-by-step guide, which we're not going to worry about right now, additional details, which we're not going to really deal with it right now either. What we're interested in is these two things, the income documentation guide and the forms. Now, the income documentation guide and the forms are the two things that are the most important and the things that you will need to use when you are applying for your loan modification. So we're going to take these out of the box, the folder, and we are going to put this other stuff to the side here. We're going to focus on this. Income documentation guide is a really beautiful thing. I've actually never seen this before, but it's super helpful. And I think that you can benefit from what Wells Fargo has created for their clients. This basically goes through the different statuses for the person. This first one here is I'm employed. The second one is I'm unemployed. The third one here is I'm self-employed. I'm an active military member of the military, active military reserves. I'm retired, I'm divorced, I have tenant or boarder income, and I'll tell you what the difference between that is in the second one, which is I have rental income and I'm receiving other assistance. What this document's doing is giving you basic information about the different things that you need to provide to the bank depending on your situation. So, for example, let's say that you're employed. Employed means that you receive W-2 income. W-2 income means that you have a job, such as if you work at the post office, or if you work for a bank, or if you work for some large corporation or some small corporation and you receive W-2, which means that your employer takes out your taxes every week and pays the taxes for you and you get a check minus your taxes. If you have that situation, all they're requiring is two of the most recent pay stubs and your most recent tax return. Most banks, if you are a regular employee like this, a W-2 employee, they require very minimal documentation for your income, and that those are the two things that they're going to require. They also require a form that I'm going to show you in a second. If you new at your job and you don't have the pay stubs, then there's a letter of employment, which might be a good thing to get anyway, even if you've been in your job for a little while, especially if you have a change of income, either your income has gone up or down. A letter of employment might be good from your HR that says that your income is higher or lower than what your papers show. Now, if you're unemployed, which a lot of people are right now, you can still apply for a loan modification. They're going to ask you for a unemployment benefit award letter. It's very difficult to get a loan modification when you're unemployed. However, it is possible. So they will require the unemployment benefit award letter from the state where you are getting unemployment. So go get that and apply with that. Now, self-employed is the most difficult. Self-employed, basically, they require a lot more documentation than regular employed people with W-2s. You need your tax returns, your two most recent tax returns, which is one from your business and one from your personal, and your business quarterly or year-to-date profit and loss statement. You need to create this document if you're going to apply for a loan modification as a self-employed person. Your year-to-date profit and loss statement has to match the forms that you're going to be filling out in a second. So it's very important that you get this done professionally, or you use some sort of software, or you watch a YouTube, or figure out some way to do this properly. If this doesn't match, you're going to get denied. Self-employed people have the hardest time getting loan modifications because of this documentation that they're required. It's only a few things, but this profit and loss is always a issue for people who are self-employed when getting a loan modification. They also ask for bank statements. The reason they're asking for bank statements is so that you can prove that your year-to-date profit and loss statement is real. So those are the things you're going to require. This one says 2 months. I would get 6 months because they're going to always come back and ask you for more. If you're active military, they ask you for earning statement. This is something similar to a W-2 that you can get. The same thing if you're a reserve member. These are the documentation that they require. If you're retired, you have a retirement statement from the government. That's something that the award letter and the receipt of payment. Now, what they want from there is they want to show your bank statement that you're actually receiving the money from the government and it's being deposited into your account. If you're divorced, they want your agreement, your separation agreement, to determine what the status of the property is, who's paying for the property. If you have a marital settlement agreement that says that the other spouse is paying, they're going to want to see that. So you might as well get that information ready because they will ask you for that. Now, some people use tenant or rental income to apply for loan modification. Now, there's a big difference. A tenant is somebody who actually lives with you. So if you rent a room in the house, then you have a tenant boarder situation. What they want from a tenant boarder is a proof of occupancy from your tenant, your personal bank statements that shows that the money that you're receiving from your tenant, from your boarder, is actually being deposited into your account, and a fully executed lease agreement. If you don't have a lease, then they definitely require the bank statements to show that you're depositing the amount. Now, this is really important. The way they treat this tenant income, it's not 100% of what you show. So if you collect $1,000 in tenant income, the bank will not give you $1,000 of credit. They'll give you 75% of that. So if you collect $1,000, you're only going to get $750 worth of credit for your $1,000. But it's still important to have it. Your rental income, what this second part here is if you have the entire house rented. You can still apply for loan modification if you have a rental property. A lot of people don't know that. The way that the bank determines how to deal with that situation is they ask for the rental income. The rental income is the money that you collect from your tenant and that you are depositing to your account. The only way they're going to give you this loan modification is if you are 100% honest with the IRS and you have declared that rental income as income to the IRS and you have a tax return that shows that. If you don't have that, the bank won't, they won't give you anything. So if you have rental income, then you can still apply for a loan modification, but it needs to be shown on your taxes as such. You can have all the deductions, all the things that you need, but that initial $1,000, $2,000 that you're collecting in rent has to be shown as a gross income for the property for as long as it's rented. You're also gonna need to show receipt of the rent, which means that you have rent checks or that there's some deposit into your account with your wire transfers or whatever into your account showing that activity. Again, there is some form to apply if you receive Social Security, disability, or death benefit, or food stamps. Sometimes people receive this with a W-2. So definitely, if you're receiving financial assistance, you still can apply for loan modification, but you need to show it to the bank. So have that those statements ready, the benefit letter or the statement showing what you receive, and you're gonna have it being deposited into your account or how you received the payment. Now, the next thing that we need to look at are the forms. This is the most important part of the application because this is the actual application. So what do we have here? We have a few things that the bank has provided for us. The first thing is the mortgage assistant application. The mortgage assistant application is the form that you fill out, which is the basic information so that you can apply for loan modification. Simple stuff, your name, the co-borrower. Co-borrower is the other person, so if you're married or if you have somebody else in your household that used their credit to rent, use their credit to borrow and get the mortgage, they are the co-borrower. They would need that information here too. Pay attention to all the small things they ask for. They ask if your property is the primary residence. Now, be very careful with this. If you start putting one application as primary, then the next one next month is investment, the bank's gonna catch on to that. If you live in the property, make sure that you are honest and you say it's a primary residence. If it's not a primary residence, don't call it such and call it an investment property or a secondary residence. These are all very subtle changes, but they do change the equation. They do change the math when you're applying. So be sure that what you're doing is correct and honest. If you start applying 1 month with a primary residence and then when you get denied, then you turn around and try to apply it as an investment property, it better be honest and it better have the documentation to prove each one of those statuses. The next thing is who's renting, who lives in the property. If you use border income, you need to put renter. And what is your intent? Your intent here obviously is to keep it. You don't want to put that you want to transfer ownership or do anything else. There is a line here for the homeowner associations. Make sure you're honest there because the homeowner association dues do play a factor. They do change the amount of money that you qualify for. So be sure to be honest. Be sure to put that what your payment is and if you're current or not. There's a couple of things about insurance. Usually the insurance is paid for through escrow, so that's not a problem. Here it talks about your employment, when you started, if you're self-employed, when you open your company. Make sure that these dates are accurate because the bank will check. This is a financial affidavit worksheet. Now, what you want to do here is you need to put your gross salary. And remember, the way they determine this is if you have a W-2 income, you get 26 payments a year if you get paid biweekly. You take one of your payments, the gross amount, multiply that by 26 and divide it by 12. That's how you determine your monthly income. Now, don't put the net, because there, even though we all think, well, the net is really what we should be what they should be using to determine our loan modification payment. It's not the net, it's the gross. So be sure to put the gross, your gross income. Your self-employment income here is if you're self-employed, you understand that and you put that there. All the other incomes that you have are all listed here. Rental income, here it is. Rental income minus your mortgage, minus your expenses to keep your renter. then you have your assets here at the bottom. It's going to ask you how much money you have in your checking account, your savings account, your stocks, and other things. So be very honest here, because the bank will just ask you to prove it, and you don't want to lie. Because if you lie, the bank will just deny you, and it's over. Or they'll just keep you in a quagmire of never making a decision, which is worse than being denied. Now, your next form here is your monthly household expenses. Here you have to put the actual mortgage payment that you're currently paying. Your, if that includes your property taxes and homeowners insurance, just put the full amount in the top there. Now, even though you could be 2 to 5 years late, just determine what your mortgage payment is and put it there. It doesn't matter. They still use that amount. Your association, even if you're late, you put it there. Your if this is an investment property and you're paying rent somewhere else, you need to put that there. All your other expenses, your total credit card bills, your tuition expenses, your student loans, all these things are very important. You put all these things in here. Be sure to be as accurate as possible, because the bank will check. And they will sometimes even ask you for bank statements to justify all these different costs. This next form is the hardship affidavit. Hardship affidavit is, you need to explain to the bank what happened in your life to qualify for a loan modification. There is no magic word or phrase that you should put in here that will guarantee your loan modification. However, there are things that will, if you put them in this affidavit, will cause the bank not to give you a loan modification. For example, a lot of people say, well, I didn't feel like paying because the payment was too high and I thought the property wasn't worth it, or something like that. If you put things like that in here, the bank is going to deny you. The true reason most people apply for loan modification is because their work has gone down, their income has been decreased somehow, and they're making less money. That's the reason. Put that in the affidavit if that's your reason. If your business has shut down, if you have lost employment of one of the two spouses, if there's a sickness, things, you put them in here. There's all kinds of different things here, divorce, separation, all those things. Put in here, do a little bit of writing, you know, write a couple sentences, don't leave it blank. And, you know, this is your chance to tell the bank what you think in terms of why they should give you a loan modification. It's not the only factor, but if you leave it blank, they're not going to give it to you. So that's the hardship affidavit. Be sure to pay attention to that. This is a form you need to sign. This basically says that they really don't have to give you anything if they don't want to, but they will try to give you what they can. So make sure to sign it. And they're also asking you to sign under oath that everything that you put in the previous forms is true and accurate. So if you lie here, you know, you're not helping yourself out, and you're basically lying under oath, which is never a good thing. You never want to do that. The next form, and every single bank asks for this, is the 4506T. Is a request for a transcript of your tax return. This form they will send to the IRS. And what they're asking to do, even though you are going to submit your tax returns with the application, they still ask for the transcripts, because a lot of people, sometimes they might fake their tax returns and the tax returns aren't actually real. So they want to confirm that the tax return that you submitted to the bank is the actual tax return that you submitted to the IRS. And the only way for them to do that is with this form. So be sure to fill it out. And there's a couple things here you need to, let me see, it's already checked off what they want. So you basically just fill it out. You, down here it says the year period requested, be sure that you ask for the last 3 years. So if we're in 2020, you're probably gonna ask for 19, 18, and 17, and make sure that they get all three, and then sign it. This is a form that they have, a lot of banks have this too, that basically they are allowed to look at your tax returns and use them for whatever purpose they have in terms of your loan modification. It's not, they're not gonna publish any information about you, but this is really important. This is something that you need to sign. Now, this is a non borrower financial contribution form. A lot of people, what happens is they have a non-borrower living with them. This could be an adult child, an adult son or daughter. This could be some other person that lives with you. This basically says that this other person is going to financially contribute to the household so that you can better afford a loan modification. This happens a lot with older people when they have, when they're retiring and they might have an older son or daughter. You need to put the name of the person here, and this is very important. Will you contribute all of your income to the household expenses and mortgages? If you put yes, then you're going to need to show what that income is. And if you put no, you need to put how much they're going to contribute. Now, this contribution needs to be deposited into a bank. This is not just you fill out whatever you want here and then nothing happens. The money has to be put into the borrower's bank account so that the borrower then can take to the borrower can take it to the bank, and the bank can determine that yes, there is non-borrower income going into the account, and the person will be able to afford this house with the non-borrower financial forms, financial contribution. So that's really important. And it requires a non-borrower signature. This does not obligate the non-borrower to anything. It doesn't make them responsible for the mortgage. It just says that the non-borrower, the person that lives in the home that's not on the note or not on the mortgage will be assisting the borrower. This is a cover sheet, something that this particular bank requires, but not all banks require that. So that's it. I hope that helped you understand how to fill out the loan modification application. Each situation is different, but the forms are all the same. Be sure to spend the time necessary to be accurate and honest on your forms so the bank can make the best determination for you. But remember, the banks are not your friends. The banks will not help you if you do not help yourself. My name is Diego Mendez. I'm a loan modification and bankruptcy attorney here in Miami, Florida. I've helped thousands of people with their loan modifications. I do these videos to help you fill out your forms and maybe get a lower payment and save your home. Please subscribe and like my videos, and I will keep making these videos related to debt, foreclosures, loan modifications, forbearances, bankruptcy, and other topics, all with the goal of helping you get on with your life after coronavirus. Thank you very much.